Stress, depression, and severe mental illness can happen to anyone. Team Wellness Center has been helping those struggling with these conditions in southeastern Michigan.
They get a chance to know that somebody's on their team.
We think nobody else feels the pain that we feel. We feel like I'm the only one, but that is so untrue.
Within 24 hours of reaching out to our team, members receive psychiatric evaluations and begin the necessary treatment for recovery.
Working through my problems and seeing that I'm not the only one that has to cope has really brought me to a place where now it's okay to talk about it.
Because if you keep stuff to yourself, you know, you can't overcome. We all need one another.
Team Wellness Center, you are not alone.
By now, most people are familiar with the story of Detroit's Rick Wershe Jr., aka White Boy Rick, the longest serving nonviolent offender on the planet. Dozens of news features, documentaries, even a full-length Hollywood movie have been made about him. And pretty much everyone who knows his story knows that there are so many things wrong with this story. A child becomes seduced by and immersed in a high-stakes life of money, excitement, and violent crime. At age 14, he is entrapped by the federal government to be used as a drug informant. Then this same child, this pawn of legitimate power, is set up and punished for the very life he was led into and the activities he was coerced into carrying out. Stay with us as we meet the real Rick Wershe Jr. and talk about the real story, including his long, long struggle for justice. Welcome to My Healthy Mind. I'm Michael Hunter. The man you're about to meet, Rick Wershe Jr., is famous, or should I say infamous, all around the world. He's the longest serving nonviolent offender anywhere. But the one thing no one has ever talked about is what Rick's thoughts and feelings have been concerning his crimes and his punishments. Why? Because no one ever asked him. Today, My Healthy Mind talks with Rick about what was going on in his mind during the long journey from child drug dealer and informant to free man. Rick Wershe Jr., welcome to My Healthy Mind.
Thanks for having me.
Rick, you've got quite a story to tell, one that's been told many times over. But why don't you give us a summary, like a biographical summary of the chain of events before we delve into the detail?
As a kid, what I remember the most is my mom leaving. You know, my mom and dad separated and went through a bitter divorce, and I ended up living with my father on the east side of Detroit. So primarily, I was raised by my father and his parents, my grandmother and grandfather. So, you know, I didn't have a bad childhood, but I didn't have a normal childhood. My grandmother tried to make sure, because I didn't have a mother, that I had a normal life. I guess as a child, it was a blue-collar east side. I mean, the east side of Detroit's always been, you know, kind of violent and not too good of an area. But you know, if you live there, I love it still to this day. I love Detroit. I love where I came from. You know, it was a tight-knit community, but there was poverty, and where you find poverty, you find a high crime rate.
And with that, what influence did it have on you when you were a teenager?
I wouldn't say it so much had an influence on me as a teenager until I was, you know, until I went down the path of getting involved in the drug trade. Because before then, my grandmother and grandfather kind of, you know, they both worked at Chrysler for 40 years, and My dad was an entrepreneur trying to, we really stayed there because of his parents. So had it not been for my grandmother and grandfather wanting to stay there, I think we would have moved long ago.
And they were pretty positive people and upstanding citizens.
Yeah, absolutely. Never been in any trouble. I was the only one in my family that actually found trouble. You know, my grandmother and grandfather, I don't think they ever missed a Sunday in church. I wasn't in any trouble, Mike, until I was, you know, till I started working for the government and you know, as I got older, you know, you get in the streets more and more and there was more things to get into. Growing up in Detroit, you know, we grew up, you know, having snowball fights and playing as normal kids. But as we grew older and the neighborhood changed, you grow up too fast sometimes. And, you know, as I like to say, I had a childhood, but I really didn't have a childhood, because you grow up too fast in some of these areas. And, you know, my grandparents always tried to make sure that we had a childhood, but some of the things that become normal in the inner city, like your friends dying, that shouldn't be normal for a child. I had a friend, you know, during a football game, a pickup game of football, he got in a fight, kid stabbed him, he died. I had another friend that was killed over his coat. So what happens down there, Mike, is it hardens you. Like, you know, for a child, a funeral shouldn't be a normal thing. Going to your friend's funeral when you're a teenager shouldn't be normal. But if you go down into the inner cities, not just in Detroit, go to Baltimore, go to LA, go to these inner cities. Death becomes normal, and it's not normal. It shouldn't be normal. It's sad. When you grow up down there or in any inner city, we all have it in us, men, women, children. You once you reach a certain age, you have a survival instinct, and you do things that might not be the best thing to do, but you do it out of survival. You know, that mode kicks in, that part of your brain that says, you have to do this to survive, and you do it.
Rick, you had a chance to live outside of the inner city, and then you came back. Can you tell us about that?
For 1 year, as a kid, I wanted to get to know my mother. I didn't know my mother, so I kept running away. I would run across 8 Mile, and they told me they were going to lock me up. They told me this, but as a kid, I wanted to get to know my mother. So finally, my dad finally said, you know what? Go home, pack your stuff, and go. And I got to move out to the suburbs for a year, and it was life-changing. I met Michelle. She was my first girlfriend, who's my fiance now. So, you know, I met friends that I never lost touch with, but it was amazing that just a short stone's throw away, the difference in life as what I thought was normal to what these suburban kids thought was normal. And I was, you know, this kid from Detroit, so I was a little rougher around the edges than the kids where I moved to. And, you know, the school, everything was different. There was no violence, there was no, you know, poverty. It was just a different lifestyle, Mike, something that I had never seen before or wasn't accustomed to. And then I had to move back, and that's when my whole life changed. And I think I was 13 when I came back to Detroit. Crack had exploded onto the scene. I had friends, you know, that when I came home, they were like, oh, where you been? You know, blah, blah, blah. I missed you, this, because I didn't visit for that year. And that was kind of my segue into the street life, so to speak, because when I came home from that, the streets were bustling alive. Crack had exploded. I had never saw crack in my life. You know what I mean? I never sold drugs in my life until I started working for the government. Even though my friends that were older than me, I saw them driving Mercedes Benzes and BMWs, and I was like, what happened? I've been gone a year. And that was when the first time I saw a piece of crack, didn't know what it was. And, you know, it changed the way people lived in the inner city. It was so different, you know, that this one little piece of drug brought so much pain, but so much wealth. Because kids that I knew growing up, their families were dirt poor. Now I see them driving $50,000, $60,000 cars, wearing Gucci shoes and you know, wearing the newest Air Jordans. And I was like, well, where's all this coming from? And that's where I started to learn, you know, and hang around people. I never sold drugs then. You know, it was much different than, say, from 5 to 12 when I moved away, where I had birthday parties and where my grandmother tried to make sure, because I didn't have a mother, that I had a normal life, and where I went to Our Savior Lutheran Church and where I played on the church baseball team, and where they tried to, you know, keep me sheltered from this life. You know, my grandmother, when I got older, she would sit and watch in her window, and she would say, Ricky, what time did you come home? And I'd say, oh, I don't know, 9 o'clock. And she'd say, no. And she knew exactly what time I came home, because she was worried about me so much that she sat up in her kitchen and watched our front door.
So you went to work for the government at the age of 14. And what did you do for them?
That was when the government came and asked my dad some questions, and my sister had become addicted to drugs. And my dad reached out for help. And that was, you know, that was another segue for me to the government and to them saying, well, your son knows who these people are. And I did. I played basketball with them. I didn't know what they were doing or the money that they were making. I just knew they were living good and selling something they called crack. I was 13 years old. And that was where I learned or got my education real fast about the streets. I didn't set out to be a drug dealer. I was sent down that path. And I became a drug dealer by what was taught to me. But I never thought that I was affecting people's lives or people's families. You kind of, like when you're a kid or a younger person, it's all about survival. And if they drop you off somewhere, your first instinct is to survive. Basically, I was working for them. They were giving me money, and they were, you know, it was all under the table. It wasn't, I don't think anything they did was legal. I couldn't imagine it being legal to let a kid sell drugs or buy drugs at the age of 14.
And when you were in that life at the age of 14, was it a glamorous life? Like, did you enjoy it? Was it exciting? What was that like?
Yeah, I'll say it was, you know, it was exciting. You know, when I was 15, I got to travel to Las Vegas. Who does that? You know what I mean? I was given a fake ID that said I was 21. It was exciting. People say I never had an addiction, but I believe I became addicted to the fast life.
To the glamour and...
To the glamour, to the things that came with it, to the travel, to the cars, to the jewelry, to the lifestyle.
And in that lifestyle, you were close enough to other people who were probably older than you, and they were doing illegal things.
Yeah, absolutely. I was the youngest one. Typically, the people that I was hanging around were probably 10 years older than me.
And was it a dangerous life?
Absolutely. I mean, the drug world's not a safe place. The streets are not a safe place. I was shot in the stomach when I was 15 years old.
And the government didn't step in and help you out on your behalf or anything like that?
Actually, they used me more after I was shot, because it kind of gave me more street credibility that I didn't tell on the person that shot me.
And all of this time, you were never violent yourself. You were just, in that sense, a victim of a violent crime.
Exactly. I was a kid, you know what I mean? You know, spending the time I spent in prison and reading the books that I read, and, you know, your brain isn't nearly developed when you're 14, 15, 16 years old. And the decision-making part of your brain, as you're aware, your prefrontal cortex, in a male, it's not developed until you're 28. So a lot of the things that we hold people accountable for as juveniles or even as young adults, it's really not fair.
And with that fairness, so eventually you got arrested as a teenager.
17 years old.
And while you're in, because of the process, you're in the county jail and you're waiting, probably sentencing, pre-sentencing, that kind of thing. What was going through your mind then as a kid still?
Truthfully, I don't think I grasped that I was facing spending the rest of my life in prison. You know, I was 17 years old. I'm like, I thought someone would tell the truth, that someone would come forward and say, hey, this isn't right. You know, even a lot of the guards that worked in there, they were like, oh, you're not going to do this much time. You're a kid. It's a nonviolent drug crime. I never thought that I would serve almost 33 years in prison.
And how long were you in the county jail before sentencing? What was that like?
Probably a month. The county jail is not a nice place. It's not supposed to be, but I don't know how it is now. But back then, you know, the old jail, it was horrible. There was, you know, it was infested with rats, the sounds, the people with mental illnesses screaming and beating on the bars. And some of those sounds, you know, if I close my eyes and sit back, I can hear them today.
And as a young kid, you're facing that time. You're going back and forth. I'm assuming you have an attorney. The people you're working for never stepped up and said, hey, give him immunity because he's working for us.
No, they lied. They never came forward. They never told the truth. They left me, they hung me out to dry, so to speak.
And eventually you were sentenced. And what was that like?
I think that's when it sunk in a little bit, when I heard those words, you know, that I sentence you to the rest of your natural life.
So you're told your natural life, and you're trying to let that sink in.
I immediately went into fight mode. Like, with attorneys, with my whole life, I've been a survivor, Mike. So I said, you know, if I fight this, there has to be a way out. And I fought it for 30 years, you know, until I was released.
And what was that fight like? So you're in there, you're a young man, you're still a kid. And what did you do to survive 32 years?
I never lost faith. I thought that one day that someone would come forward, and someone did much later in life. But the first thing I did in prison was, you know, I made the conscious decision that I wasn't gonna let prison become my life. And a lot of people, when you're there for a long time, prison becomes your life. What goes on within those walls is a different world. And whether it was through reading, writing, whatever I could do, I never let prison become my life. So my escape might've been a television program, a show like My Healthy Mind. I tried to watch educational things. I watched a lot of sports. But I didn't get caught up in, you know, things that wouldn't help me progress as a person, because I had to grow up in there. And I had to do that on my own. And there's a lot of people that go to prison, Mike, that don't grow up because they were in there when they were 16, 17 years old. And they get stuck. And the one thing that I wanted to do was grow up. I had never caught a misconduct. I was put in maximum security prisons. I was the youngest one in Marquette Maximum Security Prison. Like, there was a lot of things. Even the people there questioned why this was being done to me.
And did you have any spiritual anchors? Did you have any connection still to people who were not incarcerated?
Yeah, I had, you know, family, of course, and I would go to some religious programs in there where people from the outside would come in and talk to you and things like that. And you know, I had a guy, when I first got to prison, I'll never forget, the school had got burned down in a riot. So they had trailers set up, and I was in this trailer, and everybody's playing cards and shooting dice, and the teacher really didn't care. And there was this young teacher, his name was Ken Jackson, and he came in the trailer one day and he said, "Come here." I said, "What's up, Mr. Jackson?" He said, "You're in my room." And I said, "No, I'm not, I'm in here." And the teacher I was in was Mr. Heller. And Ken Jackson was probably 30-year-old African-American. He said, "You're in my class, let's go." Well, our trailer was all broke down and messed up. And when I got to his trailer, it was brand new and it had all these Apple computers, which I had never saw. And he said, "You're gonna get your GED and I'm gonna help you get into college." And to this day, I've never seen him and been able to thank him, but within a year I had a GED and was enrolled in college courses. And had he not intervened, I would have been in that trailer playing cards and shooting dice.
Wow, that's amazing. And the fact that you still remember his name and can
acknowledge that. I'll never forget him.
So who else have been in your life during that time, or even now, that helped you aspire to the person that you are?
There was, you know, along the way in prison, there's a lot of people that work in prisons that shouldn't work in prisons because they think it's their job to punish you further, which it's not. Your punishment is being there. But along the way, I met a lot of good people that worked in the prison system that helped me a lot. They knew what was being done to me was wrong. And, you know, they kind of tried to help me out. And I went through a tough time when my dad was passing away. And some of the counselors and other people, they really went out of their way to help me.
And so you are in this situation where you are obviously getting older, growing up, recognizing that there was an injustice that you were a victim of, and you have so many odds against you, but you're still making sure that you're focused and grounded. What do you attribute that to?
My stubbornness.
Okay.
I guess because I was so young, I couldn't say now that if you lived your whole life out here and then they took you at 50 years old and put you in a prison. But because I was so young, I think I was able to adapt and overcome. And I put in my mind, Mike, that I'll never let these people break me. And mentally, I never let them break me. I wouldn't, even when I did break down, I wouldn't let them see it. Because some of them that worked there found joy in breaking people down.
Did you ever think, I'm gonna get out of here one day?
Every day I thought I'm gonna get out of here. I never lost that hope. I never lost that faith that one day these doors are gonna swing the other way.
So eventually, one day, you got information that you were coming out, that you were coming home, that you were going to be set free. What was that like?
It was emotional. You know, I always thought it would happen, but when I found out, I kind of broke down.
At Team Wellness Primary Care Center, you'll find all the basic services you need to be well and stay well. Come in for all your screenings. Come in for routine physicals and checkups. Come in for full service dentistry. Come in for vaccinations and immunizations. At Team Wellness Primary Care Center, we take care of your total health. Team Wellness Primary Care Center. Come on in. At Team Wellness Dental Clinics, you'll find plenty to smile about. Our friendly professional dentists and hygienists are here to give you the full range of preventative and remedial care you need for a beautiful, lasting smile. From diagnostics to routine cleanings, our team does it all, right in your neighborhood. So whether you come to us or we come to you, you'll get the kind of dental care you need to keep smiling. Team Wellness Dental Clinics, now serving communities all over Metro Detroit.
Anxiety, depression, can happen to anyone. for all kinds of reasons, especially during difficult and trying times, that no one should have to go through alone. At Team Wellness, trained, compassionate, caring professionals will get you into the right treatment so you get better. Team Wellness, you are not alone.
Thank you for being with us today for part one in the harrowing story of Rick Wershe Jr. Please join us again next week as we continue with his 32-year struggle for justice. If you'd like to learn more about this or any mental health issue, please visit us at our website, myhealthymind.com, on Twitter at @MyHealthyMindShow, or on Facebook. We'll see you next week for another edition of My Healthy Mind. Let's talk about it. Don't forget to like, share, comment, and subscribe for more content from My Healthy Mind. Let's talk about it.
Until recently, people in psychiatric crisis had very few options. Basically, they could be taken to a hospital emergency room and inpatient treatment, or to jail. But now, there's a better way. Team Wellness Psychiatric Urgent Care Center of Metro Detroit, an official certified community behavioral health clinic. What this means is that now, people experiencing any kind of mental health or substance abuse crisis can be taken immediately and directly into treatment at our safe, certified crisis stabilization unit to be immediately assessed, stabilized, and triaged by our team of intake medical doctors and psychiatrists. To undergo intensive psychiatric therapy for up to 23 hours in one of our private or semi-private rooms. To be fully evaluated for short-term care and given a warm handoff into proper ongoing treatment. And to receive continuing long-term clinical and peer support services based on a thorough, thoughtful discharge plan drawn up case by case. For those in the throes of a substance abuse crisis, our response would be the effective, evidence-based practice for treating substance abuse, including Suboxone. In cases of attempted suicide, certified suicide prevention specialists are on call and our mobile crisis response team ready for dispatch. In any mental health emergency, our psych urgent care unit is open 24/7 to receive and treat those in crisis. And in all these cases, law enforcement can bring the subjects to Team Wellness to divert from jail or the emergency room. This kind of direct access will save time and save lives. Team Wellness Psychiatric Urgent Care. Certified, safe.